And so in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. And so, good evening, everyone. On behalf of the Clares and myself, you're very welcome to the first night of our November Remembrance Masses. Welcome those who join us virtually, those who have come tonight to remember their loved ones. We are united in prayer and in faith. I want to welcome back tonight our ladies' choir. It's been 20 months now since we've had a choir here in St. Clair's, and it's great to see them. In fact, it's only a half a choir because of the restrictions, and we have to have the split to two, and hopefully soon they will be all back in the one choir. So welcome, and it's great to have them back as well. We come tonight to remember our loved ones. And this November days, when the leaves are falling from the trees and things begin to look bleak, and we know that death is all around us. But we know too that springtime will come and new life will emerge. And tonight we know that new life has emerged for our loved ones who have died. It's important to remember them, because when we do, their memory stays with us and they themselves stay with us too. We remember them with the Eucharist, the great prayer of our faith. Remembering what Jesus asked us to do at the Last Supper, do this in memory of me. We remember tonight that Jesus died and rose again and has promised the same for all who believe in him. Where our loved ones are, we hope one day to be too. So let us just acknowledge that as humans we do make mistakes. So let us pray for worthiness for this Mass and also to take our place in heaven one day by pausing and just calling to mind any faults or failures. And so we pray now together. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and in what I have failed to do, through my fault, through my most grievous fault. Therefore I ask the Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, bring us to everlasting life. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. I invite you to join together as we pray the opening prayer. Loving God, we come tonight struggling for words to express our feelings, lost for words to express our thanks for all that they who have died have meant to us. We come with sorrow as we think of our loss, with gratitude as we recall the persons they were, and with praise as we remember all that you have done to them, with faith as we recommit them to your eternal care. Loving God, draw near to us as we draw near to you. Speak to us through the words of Scripture, to our prayers, to all that we shall share, so that believing in the gospel and trusting in Christ, we may receive the comfort, peace, and strength you long to give us, and find hope in this life and in the life to come. We make this prayer through Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated now. I'm going to invite Nicola to read the Word of God.
A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Thessalonians. We want you to be quite certain, brothers and sisters, about those who have died, to make sure that you do not grieve for them like those people who have no hope. We believe that Jesus died and rose again, and that it will be the same for those who have died in Jesus. God will bring them with him. With such thoughts as these, you should comfort one another. The word of the Lord.
Be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Mary Magdalene stood weeping outside the tomb. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had been lying, one at the head, the other at the feet. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." When she said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not know it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you looking for?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him in Hebrew, Rabboni, which means teacher. Jesus said to her, Do not hold on to me, because I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go to my disciples and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God. Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, I have seen the Lord, and she told them that he had said these things to her. This is the Gospel of the Lord. So please be seated just for a few moments. We can all, I think, identify with Mary Magdalene, who went to the grave weeping. It was the last place that she had seen the body of Jesus. And she was devastated. We know ourselves how devastated we can get, particularly when we go to the grave of a loved one. And then she saw the empty tomb. And she saw this person whom she assumed was the gardener. In her tears, she didn't recognize Jesus. And sometimes we can be a little bit like that ourselves too. In our grief and in our sadness, we may not be able to see the bigger picture that our loved ones, like Jesus, has risen. Mary's first reaction was a reaction that we would all ourselves have made. Do not hold on to me. Do not hold on to me. That's what Jesus says to Mary, because she immediately wanted him there. He says, I have to go back to heaven to take my place there. And so that's again the natural reaction, wanting to hold on to our loved ones. The bigger picture, which we can sometimes struggle to understand and see, is that our loved ones are in heaven with God. That's the central truth of our faith. And there are many days and nights that we cannot see that bigger picture, because that's natural and it's human. We have our tears. And when we have our tears, then we have sadness in our hearts. But the important thing is as well is to fill the sadness in our hearts with the joy of memory. And it's so good that we do remember loved ones, because when we do, they become alive for us. And so in our sadness tonight, we remember 13 of our parishioners who died during the past 12 months. We will remember them. And there's 13 candles on the cross in front of the altar. The cross was where the last time Mary and the disciples saw Jesus alive. But we know now that the cross gives way to the brightness of Easter Sunday morning, the brightness of resurrection. So I invite Catherine, our sacristan, to light the candles as each name is called out, as a reminder that their light shines and that they too have overcome the cross, and that they too are shining for us as angels, saints in heaven. So the first candle that Catherine will light for us is for Robert Wynne. We think tonight of his children David and Aisling in Canada. Robert came back to Staunton Avenue when he was diagnosed with cancer a number of years ago. Looked after so well by brothers and sisters and their families. Before he went to Canada, he was a very skilled and precise toolmaker. Played soccer with St. Pat's. He was a scratch, pitch and putt player, very involved in GAA, an avid Celtic and Leeds supporter. He loved backing the horse too, socialising. He loved coming back to Ireland on holidays. He was passionate about Ireland. He loved telling everyone how his children and grandchildren were doing. We light a candle for Des Coakley. Tonight we think of his wife Joan and his children Debbie, Gina, Katrina and Killian. Des, who worked in Crotty's and the sugar factory in Corcoran's and the CE schemes in Balnabrana and Carlow Golf Club. Always interested in golf. He caddied from the age of 6, was a scratch pitch and putt player. He met his beloved Joan in Carlow Golf Club and they moved to Slatey Street then. Joan acted as his caddy and won many tournaments. The first scratch golfer in 97 years history of Carlow Golf Club. Just a natural talent. Lovely to watch. Great golf teacher. And he loved teaching juveniles in particular because he had a great love for children, especially his own grandchildren. A great family man too. And one of the first you would see pushing a pram down the street. He always showed great courage when diagnosed with his cancer. We light a candle for Brendan Maddock. We think of his wife Anne and his family, Caroline, Richard and Brendan. His early years in Ballyharmon, then a carpenter in the sugar factory until it closed. Always had a great pair of hands. His workshop in the back was always full. He was a traditional carpenter. No modern machines for Brendan, and he would use the proper timber as well. He loved his family holidays, going to Tramore and then the motor home, travelling all over Ireland with Anne. Loved to be walking the dogs to the fields or down the barrow track. Great ballroom dancer too, and many a great night out. Something he loved to see each year was the swallows arriving, and also seeing the daffodils arrive in spring. We light a candle for Fergus Keating. Think of his family, Colin, Louise, Elaine, Anthony and Rachel. Lived his life in St. Lazarian's Terrace, working in May Roberts and then had his own business on the quay with his brother PJ, Kay Brothers, making soft toys. Great love for his family and grandchildren. Always taking them for drives or walks. Any opportunity to spoil them and giving them the mint crisp bars. He worked here in our parish and our parish CE scheme as well. And faith was very, very important to Fergus and got him through the tough years of his sickness as well. Was a daily mass goer here in St. Clair's and one of the first Eucharistic ministers commissioned here in St. Clair's. We light a candle for Agnes Shaw. We think of Agnes's family, Anne, Lee, Anthony, Phil, Mary Claire and Sandra. Agnes had a great devotion to Our Lady, particularly Our Lady of Lourdes, and would have the Knox Shrine on her television, or the Lourdes Shrine put on her television by her family so that she can watch live stream from Lourdes. Great love for the Sacred Heart and also Padre Pio. That gave her great strength and kindness during her life. Her family was always a source of joy, especially her children and her grandchildren. Home always had an open door when everyone was welcome to enjoy her baking, the cup of tea and a chat. We light a candle for Hans Brooker. Tonight we think of his wife Isabel and family Linda and Anthony and their families. Hans, a German, born in Oldenburg in the old West Germany. Survivor in the mines and civil engineer that brought him literally all over the world. Wherever he went, he was always involved in his local parish. He met Isabel and was a member of in South Africa, and was a member of the parish council in South Africa. He was a volunteer worker in hospice in Leeds when Isabel and Hans retired back there. But they moved from Leeds to Grey Cullen in 2007, and great support to Isabel in all her charity works, counting money, wrapping parcels for our volunteers, working in the Thursday morning club in the parish centre. One word to describe Hans was precise. Everything had to be spot on. Any job was worth doing right. He loved his visits to Dubai too, to see his family and his grandchildren. A man of deep faith, Mass and Rosary was very important to Hans, who saw good in everyone. Also, he had an important job. He used to mind Bodhi for me on many occasions. We light a candle for Anne McGrath, and we think of Anne's brother Jim and sister-in-law Maureen tonight. His time in Hanover, spent time in Crappie Place, and eventually Beechwood Nursing Home. She had a brain injury since she was young, still managed to volunteer in St. Feig's House, was very involved in the Wheelchair Association, and all there were very good to her because they loved her company. She loved to chat and to knit, loved to go to Jennifer and Pascal in Rahindorn on Sundays, and she had many good friends who were very, very good to her and have lovely memories of Anne. We light a candle for Sister Anna Maria from the Port Clare community here. Sister Anna Maria was born in 1921. She died just short of her 100th birthday. She was born in Brackney in Offaly, the youngest of four. And her sister Patricia is a Mercy nun and will be 104 next year. Next week, sorry. Her young years were very lively. She loved the dances. And after school, she took over the running of the family pub. And she never forgot her roots. She joined the Port Clares here in Grey Cullen in 1946. And extremely dedicated to her prayer life. And prayed for the needs of the church and the world. Through her many hours spent day and night in front of the Blessed Sacrament in the Adoration Chapel. Prayed for the needs of so many as well. She loved her garden too and spent long hours in a vegetable garden. She loved nature and birds, and she loved to see them hopping around her as she worked in the garden. She always showed great welfare for every creature. Very good organist and played violin and had a great community spirit. Noted for her kindness and goodness to everyone. Was a wonderful reader and storyteller, and was always entertaining people with her jokes. So we give thanks to God for almost 75 years of service here to our parish. We light a candle tonight for Tony Burke. We think of his wife Pauline and family Lisa, Tony and Carol in England. We think of Tony growing up in Collession. Collession was a huge part of Tony's life. Playing football, winning many titles with Collession and Laois, and he was in goal for the 1967 All-Ireland final at minor grade. He was in Collession Pipe Band too for the very beginning and was a very successful pipe major, won many national competitions. Met Pauline and they worked so well as a team. He worked in Carola Sugar Factory and also built two houses in Collession. Moved to England in 1987. Became a mini cab driver, then Tony and Pauline set up and ran a building company. Tony was the handyman and Pauline the charmer rent collector. Loved being a grandfather too. He carried a cross of sickness with great courage and strength and would love to walk the park near his home with Pauline. We light a candle for Fergus Gaffney. We think of his sister Anne-Marie and brothers Porrick and Thomas. He loved going to Prosperous to visit his nephews and nieces, especially at Christmas. He never forget their birthdays and always brought presents to them. He had a great love of animals. He would bring stray dogs home when he was a child. Always full of knowledge, Fergus was. If you wanted to know something, just ask Fergus. He loved his computers and was so good at all things technical. Loved his can of Bulmers too, and again fought his illness with great strength and courage. We light a candle for Michael Murphy. We think of his wife Mary and family Diane, Don and Jean, an extended family. Michael, originally from Chapel Street in Grey Cullen, but moved to Carlow, was a well-known taxi driver, always very obliging and helpful to everyone. Would get up in the middle of his own Christmas dinner to bring somebody to theirs. Very involved in New Oak soccer in early years, but also too great at fishing and darts and gardening. He could grow anything. Dancing too, regular in the workman's club on Saturday night, and people would stand back and watch him jive. He loved his country music. He carried a cross of sickness for 8 years, and Mary and the family were his carers, and also his goddaughter Mairead. Faith was very important too, going to Mass in the cathedral or here in St. Clair's. We light a candle for Shay Lawler. We think of his wife Maria and daughter Diane. We think of his early life in Thompson's as a steel fabricator. But he always had that urge to be famous, and so he joined a show band at 17 as a saxophone player. Worked hard as well as playing the guitar and singing with the bands at night. He was a coal man, a milkman, a courier, and then a postmaster in Ballon for many, many years. He was known as an absolute devil, a messer, would say anything to you. Very charismatic and great entertainer, and get everyone laughing. An avid Manchester United fan, and you wouldn't get a word in when he began talking about them. A very devoted family man, and had a great love for his garden. And we light a candle too for Sinead Newlon. We think of his parents, her parents, Seamus and Jane, and brother James, and also Sinead's extended family and her many, many dear friends. Our whole parish were so saddened and shocked at her sudden death. But there was also a sense that Sinead worked miracles, and there's a sense of thanksgiving that her parents and recovered from their illness as well. Because family was so important to Sinead. Loved travelling with her parents, and also when she would be away, bringing Mam and Dad her special presence, and they had to be good. Also, her life revolved around her niece Emily, had a huge love for her. After attending Colossh de Navin, she got a great love for the Irish language. Started Gael Scola in Athahi, and through her dedication, perseverance and vision, they got a new school. And a new school today is the testimony to Sinead. Then though grew large and she missed a classroom, and she joined Gael Scola Portlaoise in 2016. Always had such a great love for children, and she treated them as if they were her own. They worshipped her. She made all feel special. If any child was down, what cheered them up was the Milchan from Winchore, Sinead. She inspired her fellow teachers too. And religion was always important in her school, as with herself. Also known for her great involvement in Grey Cullen GFC and Spree Club and other community activities. As we remember all of these tonight, let us for a moment to remember all our own loved ones who have died and whose memory is still very much with us. Because for those we remember, there will always be a place.
There's a tomorrow.
So for all who we remember, there will always be a place. Eternal rest grant unto them, O Lord. Let perpetual light shine upon them. May they rest in peace. Please stand now as the Poor Clares are going to lead us in the prayers of the faithful. So gather together in prayer. Jesus is with us when we do. We turn now with all our needs.
Safe in Jesus' loving care, in that place prepared for them and for all of us by his own death and resurrection. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
We pray that we may gain inspiration from remembering our loved ones tonight, and that we may continue to remember them so that they will always be part of our lives. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
For all who mourn and who greatly miss their loved ones, we pray that through their faith in God and the support of family and friends, they will find strength to move forward in life. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
We pray for all undertakers, the staff of funeral homes, the parish team, Poor Clare sisters, and all who journey with families through the most difficult times. May God reward them for their goodness. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
We pray for all those who have died because of COVID-19, especially those who died in isolation. Loving Father, free the world of the distress this pandemic brings, and protect the most vulnerable in our society until that day comes. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
We pray for doctors, nurses, hospital chaplains, and all who care for life at its weakest moments. May God continue to bless them, and may his healing power continue to walk through them. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us. We also remember in our prayer tonight the repose of the soul of Seamus Jim Nelson, Slatey Street, whose funeral mass will be celebrated here in St. Clair's at 10 a.m. tomorrow, with burial in Slatey Cemetery afterwards. We also pray for Breda Gagan, Nee Walker, Beechwood Park, Pollerton, Big Carlow, reposing at Carpenter's Funeral Home in Barrack Street from 4 p.m. on Saturday with prayers at 8 p.m. Removal there on Sunday to the Holy Family Church, Aska, for arriving for funeral mass at 12 noon at burial in St. Mary's Cemetery. Lord, grant all our dead eternal rest. Comfort all who mourn. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously.
So, Lord, these are our prayers. We make them to you. You are a loving, caring God as we make them now to Christ our Lord. Amen. We'll continue now with the offertory of the mass.
Keep me from love. Let all
friends, that our sacrifice may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Look with favour, we pray, O Lord, on these offerings we present to you for the souls of your servants, and just as you bestowed on them the dignity of the Christian faith, grant them now its reward. We ask this through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For as one alone he accepted death, so we might all escape from dying. As one he chose to die, so that in your sight we all might live forever. And so in company with the choirs of angels, we praise you, and with joy we now proclaim. Holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. The time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, Jesus took the bread, giving thanks, broke it, gave it to his friends, and he said, "Take this, all of you, and eat it. This is my body, which will be given up for you." In the same way, when supper was ended, Jesus took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, gave it to his friends, and he said, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. This is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant. It will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins." Then he said, "Do this in memory of me." So now we proclaim together in song the mystery of our faith. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly, we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world. Bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis our Pope, with Dennis our Bishop, and all people. Remember all our loved ones we gather to remember and to pray for at this Mass tonight and during this month of November, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us, we pray, with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the Blessed Apostles, with all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life. We may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. And so we pray through him, with him, and in him. O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever. Now we stand as we pray to a loving Father. We pray tonight for courage and for strength and for peace and for acceptance as we pray the prayer Jesus gave us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, O Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be free from sin, safe from all worries, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant our peace and unity in accordance with your will, who lives and reigns forever and ever. And now the peace of the Lord be with you always. So again, we just wish those around us now the peace of Jesus. We pray, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace. This now is Jesus. This is his body and his blood. This is Jesus who himself died for us, who rose again, who went back to heaven to prepare a place for us and for all our loved ones. This is Jesus who has told us that he is the way to that place. Happy are we to be called to his supper. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof. Only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. God sent his only begotten Son into the world so that we might have life through him. So now I invite James to read the communion reflection.
We can shed tears that they are gone, or we can smile because they have lived. We can close our eyes and pray that they will come back, or we can open our eyes and see all that they have left. Our hearts can be empty because we cannot see them, or we can be full of the love we shared. We can turn our backs on tomorrow and live in yesterday, or we can be happy for tomorrow because of yesterday. We can remember them and only that they are gone, or we can cherish their memory and let it live on. We can cry and close our minds, be empty and turn our back, or we can do what they would want, smile, open our eyes, love, and go on.
So I invite you to stand as we pray the closing prayer together. Father, send your Spirit to heal our hearts. Kindle within us the fire of your love, so that even in the midst of our sorrow and suffering, we will be able to live in joy and peace. Fill our emptiness, enable us to be fully alive, for it is only in you, God, that we live and move and have our being. Amen. So thank you all for being with us tonight and for those who joined us virtually as well. Just on behalf of the parish team, to thank you for allowing us as a parish team to journey with you through your sadness and grief, and also through your loved one's sickness as well, and also the privilege of celebrating your loved one's Requiem Mass. For many, it's been very tough, as restrictions didn't allow us to celebrate your funeral masses the way we would have liked, or to celebrate prayer with you, wake services, or whatever. But I know still, as a Christian community that we are here, that we still embrace you with our love, with our prayers at all times. So thank you again for that privilege of allowing us to journey with you. I want to thank as well Mary, our organist, and Karen, and the ladies' choir. It's really lovely to have you back, and just imagine that's only half of them. So whittle they're all together, it'll be fantastic, really fantastic all together. It was so fantastic tonight. Really lovely to have our choirs back, really. Thanks also to Nicola for coordinating our mass tonight, Nicola from the parish team. Thanks again to Angela who did the slides tonight. All our stewards, thank you very much. Our altar servers, Serena, Cordelia, thank you. Our readers and our Eucharistic ministers, Catherine, our sacristan, and again, the Poor Clares for joining us tonight as well, and for their prayers at all times for us during our sicknesses and our bereavements. So now the Lord, again, we will come back again next Friday. Again, we will remember another selection of our parishioners who died this past year. And again, everyone is welcome to join us to remember and to pray. So the Lord be with you all. May Almighty God bless us this night now in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Our Mass is ended. We go in peace to love and to serve the Lord. So safe home and stay safe, and God bless. Thank you.